So welcome, and good afternoon to everybody. My name is Ivan Krastev, and I'm one of the permanent fellows here in the Institute. We're very grateful for your coming. And also, we saw that many of you are here for the first time, so we're very grateful for Rosa for this. But because of it, we'll try to get your contacts when you're leaving. The second thing I was instructed to tell you is, because this is going to be streamlined, we're going to ask you, like in a theater, to basically work your mobile phones on a fly mode. I don't know what it means, but basically we don't want to hear you. So here comes basically, I don't have a mobile phone, so this is why. It's really not simply, people said that it's a privilege. In my case, it's also very great pleasure to introduce the speaker tonight. Because this type of three lectures, the IWM lectures on social sciences, is one of the major events that Institute have been organized since 2000. Unlike many of the other events and lectures that we're doing, we're inviting somebody to speak in the course of 1 week to deliver three lectures, and these lectures are published as a short book in several languages. And we have a great cooperation with some of the leading academic publishing houses in the world. So you, not surprisingly, you have people like Charles Taylor or Paul Ricoeur or Peter Brown that have been giving these lectures, and they have been traditionally one of the things that we have been very much proud with. And we have been talking about different things about in these lectures about truth, about meaning of life, around peace. I'm very happy to introduce you to somebody who is going to talk about the future of the war. Because I do believe that this is one of the topics that is under-discussed, at least on our part of the world. And I do believe that Rosa Brooks is a person who first deserves to have a three lectures simply by the simple fact that she took her education in three great institutions, Harvard, Oxford, and Yale. So basically, you can have first day the Harvard, then the Oxford, and then the Yale lecture of yours. But secondly, because I do believe that she was one of the very few people who try really to reflect on this very much blurring border between war and peace that we're witnessing these days. The British historian Michael Howard used to say that the war is as old as the world, but peace is a recent invention. Because it's since 19th century that peace is something more than the absence of war. These days, this type of a claim is very much problematic, and how to police the border legally, how to police also the border between war and peace is becoming the major story. And in this major story, Rosa Brooks, I do believe, is one of the most interesting voices. Also, she has a very interesting perspective to talk about this. She's a law professor in Georgetown University in Washington. She has been also very much part of the policymaking process because she was a counselor in the Department of Defense, and she was working in the first Obama administration. So she basically has the experience of somebody who had a huge expertise on law and human rights on one side, but on the other side, she has basically seen the perspective of war and peace also from the perspective of the military and basically of the people who are conducting war. So we're very grateful that Rosa agreed to come. We're very grateful that they're going to have these three lectures. And this is it, Rosa Brooks.
I'm already on. My goodness. Okay. Thank you, Yvonne. It's really terrific to be here, and it is a real honor to be here. When I received an email from Yvonne asking if I'd be interested in doing these lectures and referring me to the website with a list of past lecturers, I realized this was a very august company to be in. So it's really wonderful to be here, and thank you all for coming. Yvonne did tell me, he warned me that here in Europe people don't like to talk about war, they like to talk about peace. And so I might have to do a little bit of heavy lifting to convince you all that it's important to talk about war nevertheless. And I think I'll just start out with a quote that is often attributed to Trotsky, although probably quite wrongly. There's no evidence that he ever really said it, but it's an excellent quote, so I'll say it. Which was, you may not be interested in war, but war is interested in you. And this, I think, is true. I'm going to talk about the ways in which I think war War is bursting its boundaries, bursting its legal and political boundaries in a way that certainly began well before the 9/11 attacks, but accelerated dramatically after that, and I think is likely to continue to accelerate. And I'm going to talk about why this matters to us, why this should matter to us, even if you don't think it should matter to you. Specifically, over the course of these three lectures, I'm going to talk about the ways in which both the international legal order and national law in most countries in Europe, in the United States, et cetera, really are premised on our ability to tell the difference between war and not war. I won't even say peace, but war and not war. Conflict and the lack of conflict, hostilities and the lack of hostilities, in ways that are sometimes invisible to us. So I'm going to talk in this first lecture primarily about the ways. I'm going to talk more about the past than about the present, and in today's lecture, talk a little bit more about the ways in which human societies historically have tried to police the boundaries between war and not war, and some of the reasons that they've done so. I'm going to talk a little bit about efforts to tame war, to contain war, to make war rule-bound. Then in the second lecture, I'm going to talk more about war's present and war's future. Look at the ways in which some of the recently developed and emerging technologies are further transforming the nature of warfare and challenging the legal and political institutions we've designed to try to control and constrain the exercise of power, of political power, of the use of lethal force, et cetera. And then the last lecture is going to focus primarily on the consequences of the ways in which war is bursting out of its boundaries, and on what we should maybe be thinking about doing about it. Let me pause. Does this seem too loud? No, okay, all right, good. I can't quite tell. I have this strange little antenna protruding from my ear. Okay, so let me start off by saying something that on some level is crushingly obvious, which is that human societies have always felt that it was very, very important to distinguish between war and not war. It's very, very important to be able to tell the difference between war and not war. Why? Well, answer again, as I said, this is fairly obvious. It's because we assume that the behavior that is morally acceptable, legally acceptable during wartime, and the behavior that is morally and legally acceptable during times of peace are quite different, in some ways diametrically opposite. There's a famous lines from Shakespeare's Henry V. In peace, there's nothing so becomes a man as modest stillness and humility. But when the blast of war blows in our ears, then imitate the action of the tiger, stiffen the sinews, summon up the blood, disguise fair nature with hard-favored rage, then lend the eye a terrible aspect. This is a very fancy, much fancier than anything I would say, way of saying, in war you get to kill people. In war you're supposed to kill people. In war, you might even get a medal if you kill people. In peacetime, if you're not in a war, if you're not a combatant in a war, and this is as true today as it was in many societies years ago, if you go out into the street and you accost the next person passing by and you take a bottle like this and you hit them on the head with the bottle, we hope that the police come and they haul you off to prison and you're tried and you're convicted and off you go to jail because you have murdered somebody. And if you tell the police when they come to haul you away, if you explain to them that the reason you had to kill that person walking by you on the street was because he was your enemy, that will just involve the mental health professionals too, right? It won't really get you off the hook. In contrast, obviously, in the context of an armed conflict, if you're a combatant in an armed conflict, you, in fact, have a legal duty in many cases to attempt to engage and disable the enemy through killing them if necessary. And if you fail to do so, you might even be shot for desertion. So the behaviors we expect in time of war in the most basic sense are obviously very different from the behaviors that we expect in times of peace. And for that reason, nearly every human society, certainly that I am aware of, and my expertise in anthropology is limited to a master's degree, many, many years ago at Oxford. But my own research, as far as I can tell, every human society has tried to draw stark lines between war and peace, although different societies at different times have policed the boundaries between war and peace in quite different ways. Just to give the examples that we're all familiar with from the West in the last 200 years, we have essentially tried to maintain that wars should be formally declared, take place on clearly delineated battlefields, be fought by elaborately uniformed soldiers, and who operate within specialized and hierarchical military organizations. But at in different societies and in earlier times, people have found other ways to distinguish between the worlds of war and the worlds of peace. And those ways are extraordinarily varied. In some societies, they've involved things like war paint and war medicine and war music and special rituals and initiation rites that people must undergo before they are transformed from their ordinary identity into their warrior selves. And I'll give you a few examples of the, just to illustrate the kind of range of ways and the ways in which this has been so important to so many human societies, really across the globe for so long. Here's an example from Europe. Old Norse literature tells of the berserkers who changed form and personality before going into conflict, before going into combat, by donning the pelts of wolves or bears. And after shape-shifting, they viewed themselves as taking on the attributes of those wild predators. And the word, our modern word in English and many other languages, berserk, comes from the brutality of their behavior after the shape-shifting. In the what is now the United States, the Blackfoot Indians would prepare for raids by drumming on buffalo rawhide and donning war paint and war medicine, and they would move towards the enemy while singing special war songs. The Jibaro Indians of Ecuador and Peru would remove their normal head ornaments and wear special caps made of monkey skin and necklaces of jaguar teeth and paint their bodies black so that they could resemble the demons before going into war. In Melanesia, the Avotip of Melanesia would literally wear a different face. When men would go to war, they would wear a stylized neck ornament around their neck in the form of a face, and they would hold it up to cover their own face when they went into battle. They would also place an herb called acar on their tongues when they went off to war. But this could only be administered when they were safely away from their native villages because it would transform them into men and warriors of such brutal potency. The war magic was so powerful that they had to only use it when they were far away from their village, lest they turn around and become capable of killing anyone, even their own wives and children. And that idea, actually, that idea that war is a form of poison, that the warrior identity is literally toxic to ordinary community life and to ordinary forms of identity, is one that you also see in a variety of other cultures. Just another example, the Makeo of Papua New Guinea. Prior to going into war, men would fast and be sexually abstinent for 6 months or longer. During that time, they were thought of as closing off their bodies so that the war sorcery of the enemy could not penetrate their bodies. And when they returned from battle, they had to once again abstain from sexual intercourse with their wives for another period of time, because if they failed to do so before their bodies had, the war sorcery had worn off, the fear was that it would leak into both of their bodies during the sex act, killing both of them. That war was literally toxic to ordinary life. And you see this, I could go on and on and on and on, giving other examples of the ways in which different societies have sort of tried to police the lines between war and peace. Amongst many Native American tribes, the locus of political authority would also change during war and peace, that there would literally be a peace chief and a war chief, and the leader of the community would change in times of war. So the decision about are we at war, are we not at war, would not only affect identity and behavior, but would literally affect the locus of authority within the community itself. This is the kind of thing, of course, that also meant that when warriors returned, we see again many, many different cultures, different kinds of rites of cleansing and purification and reintegration so that the warrior could resume the normal identity, not be toxic to the community. And we see this even today in Rwanda, for instance, after the genocide, when the regular court system couldn't process the thousands upon thousands of people accused of participating in the genocide. Rwanda turned to the Gacaca system, which, among other things, was involved a variant of traditional reconciliation rituals and healing rituals. In Mozambique, returning warriors went through purification rituals before they could be deemed reintegrated. And lest you think that all of this is an artifact of the distant anthropological past, think of the ways that even today, modern militaries continue to, in effect, don their war paint and assume the guise of predators and go through rituals to distinguish them from ordinary people. And in the United States and certainly in several European states today still, in France and Britain, I don't know what it's like in various other states in Europe. If you're a military recruit, you undergo an experience that would not be that unfamiliar to young men in particular in cultures all around the world at many different points in history. Your hair is shorn. Your ordinary garments are taken away from you. You learn literally to speak a new language. There are there's new terminology. There are new rules. You are forced to go along with various rules that make no particular sense except within the contained world of the military academy or the boot camp or whatever it may be. I don't know if you've ever noticed the number of unit patches or weapons that are, of course, named for predatory animals, much like the Jibaro Indians or the Norse berserkers. We talk about predator drones and F-15 Falcon jets, and the Germans have their Leopard tanks, and the Italians have their Black Shark torpedoes, that we continue, even in our modern high-tech world, to try to convince ourselves, perhaps, that we don different identities when we think about going to war, and those identities are far more savage and brutal than our ordinary identities. So just as historically virtually every human culture has sought to draw a sharp line between war and peace and between the warrior identity and the ordinary identity, so too we have sought, again, virtually every society to try to find ways to tame warfare itself and make it more rule-bound, make it less a matter of unrestrained savagery and brutality. And we all think of our modern law of armed conflict, the Geneva Conventions, Hague Law, and so forth, but you can go back virtually every culture on Earth. You can see precursors to the modern law of armed conflict very, very early on, certainly going back thousands of years. And I won't run through for you any examples. The more recent developments there, of course, coming only really in the last century or so with the creation, well, last century and a half or so in the United States, the creation of the so-called Lieber Code during the American Civil War, which codified rules for armed conflict, looked very familiar. If you read the Geneva Conventions, they look very familiar even today. Shortly after that, Henri Dunant founded the International Committee of the Red Cross, and the first Geneva Convention was created and went into effect, and obviously has been, I think it was 1865, was the first Geneva Convention, if I'm not mistaken, and obviously has been updated and amended and revised and expanded upon since then. After World War II, rules on the use of force between states were also further codified in the UN Charter, which put an actual prohibition on the use of aggressive war, and I'm sure you all know there are, technically speaking, there are only three exceptions. States cannot use force against other states unless they have the authorization of the Security Council or they are acting in self-defense. And the traditional legal understanding of that was to either ward off, was either to respond to an armed attack or to ward off an imminent attack. And then the third exception was, of course, you can use force with the consent of another state inside its borders. But other than that, sovereignty, principles of sovereignty also meant principles of non-intervention. So from the beginning, we as a species, I think, have tried very, very hard to say, war is over there, not war is over here. You behave in certain ways during wartime, and it's acceptable during wartime as long as wars are bounded affairs. When they are bounded in temporary affairs, bounded in space, bounded in time, bounded, if you will, interpersonally, when we know where the war is, when the war is, and who is a warrior and who is not, we can accept a degree of brutality and savagery that would be poisonous to ordinary life, to ordinary civilization. And so we try to make sure that we kind of keep war in a nice little box over there and not let it bleed into ordinary life. And again, something I'll talk about more in the, I think probably in the second lecture in particular, let me give you a current day example of the ways in which this is important. Take US drone strikes, which I know have been controversial worldwide in the last 6, 7, 8 years. An example again of why does it matter that we can tell the difference between what is a war and what is not a war. If US drone strikes in Somalia or Yemen or Pakistan are the lawful wartime targeting of enemy combatants, then there's no legal issue and there's really no moral issue, or at least there's no moral issue that is different from the moral issue that always arises when we say, oh, war is very tragic, but perfectly legal. So if the US government is correct in concluding, as it has done, that the US is in what legally counts as an armed conflict with Al-Qaeda and its many and varied associates and associated forces, if they are correct to assume, therefore, that there is an armed conflict, and correct also to assume that the people they are targeting are enemy combatants in this armed conflict with Al-Qaeda and its far-flung associates, then again, lawful wartime targeting of an enemy combatant. If the US is wrong, legally, if it's not a war, if it's not an armed conflict, or if they're wrong to think that the people being targeted are enemy combatants, then they're murders. They're extrajudicial executions, and they're illegal under US law, they're illegal under international law. So it really matters. We really want to know the difference here, because a whole lot of things start breaking down if we can't tell the difference, and I'm going to be talking more about some of those things later on. But for now, let me talk a little bit, though, about what I mean when I say that war is bursting its boundaries and how it is doing that. And again, I'm going to start out by telling you some things that you already know, but I hope a few things that maybe you don't. 2 years before the September 11th attacks, 1999, two colonels in the Chinese People's Liberation Army named Chao Lang and Wang Zhengsu wrote a very slender little book called Unrestricted Warfare, which attracted almost no attention outside of a few China watchers in the intelligence agencies of various Western states and within China itself. But today looks quite remarkably prescient. The two Chinese colonels wrote that the three indispensable hardware elements of war, historically, have always been soldiers, weapons, and a battlefield. But they warned that this is going to cease to be true in the near future, and that humans are entering an era in which even these most basic hardware elements of war will be transformed beyond recognition. They said the wars of the future, the soldiers will be computer hackers, financiers, terrorists, drug smugglers, agents of private corporations, as well as members of organized state militaries. And their weapons would range from airplanes, cannons, poison gas, bombs, and biochemical agents, to computer viruses, net browsers, and financial derivative tools. Warfare, they wrote, would soon transcend all boundaries and limits. The battlefield will be everywhere, and all the boundaries lying between the two worlds of war and non-war, of military and non-military, will be totally destroyed. As I said, in some ways, this is a very familiar story. Globalization and our increasing global interconnectedness has brought us many great things, but it has also increased everyone's vulnerability, as has our collective increased dependence on the internet and other forms of electronic communication. North Korean hackers can bring down major US media company websites. Terrorists in Yemen can use the internet to disseminate bomb-making instructions to extremists in Boston, Massachusetts, or London, or Ankara, or Paris, or anywhere in the world. Mexican drug cartels can launder money through a series of near instantaneous financial transactions. The so-called Islamic State can bring videos of brutal hostage beheadings into every American living room via YouTube. And everything from pollution to bioengineered viruses can spread rapidly around the globe. As a result, states and their organized militaries are facing more and more competition from smaller, decentralized, non-hierarchical organizations and networks. In 1941, it took a coordinated attack by 350 Japanese military airplanes to kill 2,403 Americans at Pearl Harbor. 6 decades later, it took 19 men from 4 different countries, armed only with the kind of box cutters you could buy at any hardware store or convenience store in the United States. And they hijacked 4 civilian jets and caused the deaths of almost 3,000 people, many of them Americans, but also people from around the world. Non-state actors, even 1 or 2 individuals, can increasingly compete with states when it comes to using physical force to cause large-scale death and physical injury. But it's not just that states have more competition from non-state actors as a result of changing technologies. Individuals and non-state actors can use physical force in a way that we presume the state had a monopoly on. It's also that physical force itself has more and more competition in today's world, and this is interesting and complicated in terms of its impact and how we should feel about it, I think. But Clausewitz wrote in the 19th century that war is an act of violence to compel our opponent to fulfill our will. But our increased global interconnectedness has also created new means for clever actors, whether they're states or individuals, to achieve war's traditional ends without using physical violence. Think of cyber attacks, and this is something that may or may not be overhyped, hard to say yet, but imagine a cyber attack that brought down the electrical power grid in a major population for weeks, or a significant cyber disruption of a nation's financial infrastructure, either one of which could cause massive economic damage and could lead, albeit indirectly, to significant death and suffering. Imagine a bioengineered virus capable of killing or disabling only individuals with specific DNA signatures. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in the second lecture, not as far away as we might wish to think. Think about so-called non-lethal weapons, which the US military has been working on very actively. The US military has already developed weapons that are capable of inducing temporary painless paralysis or causing a sensation of intense heat without causing any but a transient physical sensation, no permanent harm, not even temporary harm, other than it hurts, now it stopped, when a button stops being pushed. But imagine non-lethal weapons that were capable of disabling or paralyzing just long enough to enable an opposing force to seize control of land, money, or natural resources. Would any of these methods of using coercion or asserting control fit into the Clausewitz's framework for how we defined war, which to Clausewitz had to involve violence? That's what made war war. It's not particularly clear. In fact, let me pause for a moment just to talk a little bit more about definitions of war. I've said, of course, that human beings have always sought to police the lines between war and not war. And yet, for all that, definitions of war, including in the modern law of armed conflict, remain entirely elusive. Essentially, one of the glaring gaps in the modern law of armed conflict is that it does not actually offer any definition whatsoever of armed conflict. You might think that this is a problem, and indeed it is, since the in legal terms, the law of armed conflict is lex specialis, Latin for special law, as opposed to the lex generalis, the general law. The law of armed conflict applies when and only when there is an armed conflict. And many take the view, although this is controversial in the legal community, that when there is an armed conflict, the lex specialis, the law of war, displaces ordinary law entirely. But if you don't know what an armed conflict is, then you don't know when to apply the law of armed conflict, which means that you don't know which rules apply. So going back to our initial conundrum. But when you think about war, and you think about what makes a war a war, traditionally speaking, and this is true both in the military theorists and philosophers, but also in those efforts that have been made to provide a legal definition from the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia, for instance, tried to define armed conflict and how do you know what a war is? And essentially the definitions all tend to emphasize several factors, one of which is violence. A war is not a war, no blood, no war, essentially. Game of chess is not a war. Economic sanctions, a trade war, is not a war. That for have a war, from both philosophically, traditionally, and to the extent that courts and others have sought to come up with legal definitions of war, you need to have bloody and broken bodies somewhere. So factor number one is war is violent. War is bloody and it is violent. Factor number two has to do with scale and intensity. That a barroom brawl is not a war, a duel is not a war, a murder does not count as a war, that wars are large in scale, that it's not just a little bit of violence, it's a lot of violence. Factor number three, and this is back to Clausewitz again, of course, is war has political objectives. War is not just violence for the sake of violence. War is not a spontaneous fight that breaks out and then resolves. It's not a riot. That war is something that is engaged in order to achieve a political purpose, control over territory, control over resources, control over the forms of government of a particular area or entity, for instance. So war is violent, it is large scale, it has a political purpose, and implicit in those, and you sometimes see this as an additional factor, sometimes as implicit in those other factors, it's organized. You know, it's not just spontaneous and random, it is organized as well. So ask yourself, of course, ask yourself then, as we enter a world, and we are entering this world already, as we enter a world in which increasingly both states and non-state actors, individuals, have the ability to very effectively coerce and control others without resort to physical violence. Are we still talking about war, or are we talking about something else? And the example I gave a moment ago of something like cyber attacks, at least potentially, could have a disabling and crippling effect on entire states without necessarily killing anyone in any but the most indirect sort of way. I'll talk in the second lecture about some of the technologies that render U.S. drone strikes so effective. I don't mean politically effective or strategically effective, but effective at killing the people they mean to kill, which is the mixture not just of unmanned aerial vehicle technologies, but also of big data, of the intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance assets the U.S. can bring to bear, the ability to vacuum up electronic communications, increasingly the ability to have facial recognition technologies deployed, which enable very precise targeting of specific individuals, which also is quite dramatically different from what we think of warfare in the past. When you think of World War I, for instance, and Germans and Allied soldiers shooting at each other across the trenches, they're not killing each other because they happen to personally dislike each other. They're not saying, I think I'm going to go after that guy over there because he did these bad things in the past. It's a much more straightforward matter of, I'm shooting at him because he's there. He's there and he's the enemy. Whereas increasingly we have technologies that are enabling us to say, we're going to kill that guy because of what he did, and we may watch him and follow him for days, weeks, months, even years, learning everything about him, and then we're going to kill him in particular and nobody else. It's a very individualized form of warfare. So would any of this be sort of recognized by Clausewitz? I don't know. But once again, here is the difficulty. If you don't call this war, if you choose, and think of it as we've got a box over here called war, and we've got a box over here called not war, or peace, if you prefer. If we choose to take these things and we put them in the box called war, that triggers one set of legal rules. If we choose to put them in the box over here called not war, that triggers a radically different set of legal rules. In the box called war, the rules are much more permissive with regard to the use of power, and both lethal force and other forms of power by the state. The box over here called not war is much more restrictive in terms of the use of power and lethal force by the state. So the consequences are enormous. And when the US government, for instance, says, as it did with a couple years ago, that it considered that cyber attacks could constitute acts of war sufficient to trigger a right to respond using conventional military force, that's a statement that has obviously legal implications, and it also has institutional implications. We've seen, for instance, the US has most of the funding within the United States for efforts to protect against cyber attacks is in the US Department of Defense, for instance, rather than within civilian agencies. We've seen the creation of a cyber command for the United States, an enormous military apparatus for combating cyber attacks using cyber warriors. So it has institutional consequences as well as legal consequences. Same is true, obviously, as we begin to contemplate other types of other forms of coercion and control. The potential bioengineered weapons we'll be seeing in the fairly near future, non-lethal weapons and so forth. Depending which box you choose to put them in, they're subject to a very different set of rules. Let me say a little bit more about the differences in the legal frameworks between armed conflict and not armed conflict, and the ways in which this has a fairly profound effect on how we choose to define things. The law of armed conflict, as I'm sure you all know, when you're in an armed conflict, you can kill enemy combatants, you can detain people indefinitely. You can detain people during an armed conflict for the duration of the conflict. You can detain enemy combatants. You can detain civilians in the enemy state for the duration of the conflict. You do not have to give them lawyers. You do not have to put them on trial because you're not detaining them for the purpose of punishment. You're simply detaining them to keep them off the battlefield, as it were. When you're in an armed conflict, you can surveil people, and you can censor communications, and you can destroy property, and you can commandeer property. So all kinds of things you can do in an armed conflict that are lawful during the armed conflict, and they're subject to various rules and restrictions relating to proportionality and necessity and so forth. But essentially, as I said, the rules concerning how states can exercise coercion and control, as well as how they can use lethal force, are much, much looser than if you're not in an armed conflict. If you're not in an armed conflict, if the state wants to take away your property, it has to go through a very elaborate process. If the state wants to stick you in a detention facility, it has to go through a very elaborate process, and the burden is on the state, in the context of criminal law, obviously, to prove that you're guilty, rather than the burden being on you, and it can't just lock you up and keep you there indefinitely. So everything changes. Everything changes when you're in armed conflict as a matter of international law in terms of how individuals can be treated by the state and how societies can be treated by the state. A great deal also changes in terms of domestic law, and I'll only speak about the United States since that's the context in which I know best. But in the United States, U.S. courts tend to give much, much greater deference to the executive branch when war and national security are at issue. So, for instance, there have been very, very few challenges after, since 9/11, there have been very, very few challenges to anything connected with 9/11 that have been successful in the U.S. courts, because most of them have been dismissed by courts, often because the U.S. government has invoked the so-called state secrets privilege. The state secrets privilege, as the name implies, essentially means that the government comes in and says to the judge, "Your Honor, we cannot, please don't let this trial move forward, or please don't let this evidence be produced in court, because doing whatever it may be would involve disseminating state secrets that would be harmful to the national security of the United States." And in the context of claims made by the executive branch that there is an armed conflict that is ongoing and secrets that would jeopardize that conflict, in the context of such claims, courts have tended to just roll right over and say, okay, never mind. And that has resulted in the suppression of evidence that can be obviously extremely detrimental to the case against the government when evidence is suppressed and you can't bring it forward in court. Many cases have actually been dismissed altogether. You can see this not only in that area, but in many, many other areas of U.S. law. And I won't bore you by being all law professory and giving you too many of those other examples. But essentially, whether it comes to evidentiary rules or to what level of infringements on rights are considered reasonable, courts are far more willing to grant leeway to the government when there is an armed conflict sort of lurking in the background. And it's not dissimilar in the context of margins of appreciation and derogation clauses in international human rights and European human rights documents as well. But so the more you can put in the war box, the more a state, the more a government can plausibly put in a war box, the more latitude domestically in the United States as well as internationally under the law of armed conflict, the more latitude you get in terms of how much power you can exercise, in what circumstances, and with what constraints. Again, to refer back to drone strikes, I said a few moments ago, we really want to know whether they are occurring in the context of war or not, because if they're in the context of war, they're lawful, no problem. If they're not in the context of an armed conflict, then they're murders, so we care a great deal. But the trouble is, it's very hard to know whether they occur in the context of an armed conflict or not, because when you query the executive branch of the U.S. government about any particular drone strike, and the particular individual who was targeted and the place where the targeting took place and so forth, the answer is fairly routinely, we can't tell you. We neither confirm nor deny that any particular strike carried out by any particular platform, by any particular U.S. agency occurred in any particular place. All we can tell you is that we would not engage in any such alleged strikes, which we neither confirm nor deny, were there not evidence indicating that such and such targeted individual posed a threat to the United States, was an enemy combatant, and so on. So adding to the problem is secrecy. If the nature of war is such that under domestic law, in the United States at least, under domestic, and it's certainly true, I think, certainly true in the UK and in France, and I'm not enough of an expert to be able to speak about other national legal systems, but if the mere invocation of an armed conflict is sufficient to persuade the judicial system that you do not have to reveal the information that led you to conclude that there was an armed conflict, and also sufficient to convince the judicial system that you do not have to reveal the information that led you to conclude that a particular individual was a combatant in the armed conflict, then in a sense all bets are off from a rule of law perspective, right? Because to put it in the bluntest possible terms, we then have a state that is killing people for secret reasons, in secret, all around the world, in a process that is secret, involving anonymous, unnamed officials that is then not acknowledged even after the fact. And you kind of take all of your human rights protections and so forth, and you can just, you know, you can crumple them up and put them in the trash, right? So this is why it matters if we begin to have a harder time saying with any clarity what is war and what is not war. This is why it matters if we can't tell the difference. This is why every human society has tried to say there must be a difference. There must be a box called war, and its boundaries must be clear. And the lid is supposed to stay on it, because bad things are going to happen if the lid comes off of that box. Where will this go? I don't have a clock here, so I don't know how long I have been talking. Should I be wrapping up for? Okay, so in the second talk, and I know people may have comments or questions, tricky thing about doing a series of three lectures is trying to set the stage a little bit and then move on to other issues later. So I hope you will stay with me throughout the three lectures. But in the second lecture, what I'm going to be talking about much more is going into more detail on some of the types of changing technologies and tactics that are making it harder and harder to define war with any coherency or in a consistent or principled way, and some of the consequences this is having for the rule of law, both domestically and internationally. And then, as I said in the third lecture, talking about, well, what do we do about any of this? But let me pause here, and I would be delighted to take people's comments and questions.
Thank you very much for this really wide-ranging talk. In a way, as an anthropologist, I was delighted that the United States military adventures are being looked at with the same anthropological lens as Papua New Guinea. So this is certainly a good beginning for a conversation. And with that, I would like to just open the floor.
Of war is so important, how is it that the United States has been effectively been in war but not declared war since 1941? Why has the United States chosen not to declare war when it fights wars?
The U.S. thinks it has declared war for all intents and purposes, right? I mean, nobody quite knows what a declaration of war is. There's no international legal definition of a declaration of war. There's no international treaty that says thou shalt not use force until you write a paper in the following form of words that says I declare war. So from the U.S., and the same is true actually from a U.S. legal perspective. While the U.S. Constitution says that Congress has the power to declare war, it doesn't specify what form that will take. So from the perspective, I think, and here I'll just channel the U.S. government a little bit, I think they would say, what do you not know? George Bush stood up there 2 days after the 9/11 attacks, and he said, we're in a war on terror. And we have repeated that over and over and over and over again, and we've said we war with al-Qaeda and associates over and over and over again, and Congress in 2001, the U.S. Congress passed an authorization to use military force, giving the president the authorization to use force against those connected to 9/11, and we've sort of worked some legal magic on that to domestically to enable that to extend to using force against all sorts of other people in all sorts of other places. But I'm not sure that is necessarily the problem. I think that the more troubling thing is if you think of wars traditionally, our traditional understanding of war is that they were bounded in time, they were bounded in space, and they were bounded in terms of their participants. That regardless of what specific form the declaration took, that we knew when they started and we knew when they ended. Said the war is over, and President Obama has said repeatedly that this war, like other wars, must end. Perpetual war does not serve our democracy. But the nature of not only the conflict with Al-Qaeda and its associates and associates of associates and so forth, but also increasingly the types of low-level, less violent conflict we're seeing in other parts of the world, Ukraine, the Russians, for instance, in South China Sea, variety of other places, it's far less clear that they can have either any geographic boundary or any finite beginning and end, or any particular clarity about who is part of them and who is not, since increasingly they involve, at least on one side of the conflict, non-state actors rather than state actors.
I had a question on the way you're saying just right now in your answer that the U.S. feels it declares war and feels it declares war when it can. But if you just look at the way the U.S. framed the U.S.-Iraq, the second Iraqi war, there was a genuine attempt to have the war accepted by the Security Council of the UN, a failure to do so. A discourse of George Bush on an aircraft carrier saying the war is over, which wasn't as performative as the U.S. government would like it to be. In a sense, I'd like to ask you if you actually to challenge you on how you're comparing, on the one hand, norms and attempts to norm war, which
attempts to
to put norms on war and practices. I mean, when the church in the 11th and 12th century tried to ban the crossbow and impose winter breaks, it did try to change war. Winter breaks were not respected and crossbow were massively in use, right? And that did not prevent both discussion about what war should be and transgression of it or even practices around it, which were deeply part of war. So in a sense, where I want to challenge you is if you push this comparison of looking at norms and describing practices here, then isn't it actually more of a US strategy at the moment to have the blurring of the border in order to have a free hand to have its own strategy rather than a situation imposed on it by a changing world order?
So I think it's a little bit of both. I think it is certainly accurate and fair to say that the U.S. And particularly the Bush administration, but the Obama administration as well, that the U.S. has been fairly content to say, "Oh, gee whiz, you know, what are you going to do? We would love a neat and tidy war, but gosh, the terrorists won't let us. What can you do? They keep moving around. They don't wear uniforms. Not our fault. Things are just changing." And of course, the most extreme and infamous version of this was early on in the Bush administration when President George W. Bush's White House counsel, later the Attorney General Alberto Gonzalez, wrote a memo to the president that was later leaked, saying that the nature of this new kind of war renders the Geneva Conventions quaint and obsolete. So no question about it. Has the U.S. government been happy to take advantage of the blurriness around war to engage in various things that would otherwise be much criticized, and indeed that the U.S. had itself criticized in the past? The U.S. targeted killings, for instance. The U.S. was very openly critical of Israel for using targeted killings until the U.S. started to do it, and which was justified. So yes, that is absolutely true. But I don't think that's the only thing that's going on. I think that the conflict is changing. Technologies are changing in ways that, while the U.S. is kind of, well, both the U.S. and terrorist organizations are at the vanguard, if you will, for better or for worse. Some of these changes, the combination of big data with precision technologies such as precision missiles and drones, for instance, is a real change. The global dependence on the internet and electronic communications that creates a whole new set of vulnerabilities, that's a real change. You know, the Bush administration didn't invent that. The emerging around the corner evolution of DNA-linked and genetically-linked bioweapons is going to be a real change. So the ways in which the old rules are getting more and more difficult to apply with any coherence to conflict and the types of conflicts that we're not only seeing now already in some quarters, coexisting with totally old-fashioned conflicts, Syria, for instance, Congo, where, you know, conventional weapons, lots of dead bodies. So right now we've got, they're coexisting. But I think that the ways in which conflict are changing, it's not going to go away. You know, there's not going to be some new set of leaders who will say, oh, you know, we're so sorry, we've exploited this. And indeed, I think that the tendency of many of my colleagues in the human rights community has been to say, really for the last 15 years now, to say, aha, the problem here is not that conflict is changing and it's therefore getting more and more difficult to apply a set of norms and to use a set of norms and institutions designed for one kind of conflict. It's getting more and more difficult to apply it to this new type of conflict, which just doesn't fit, these categories don't fit. They're responsive and say, no, that's wrong. That's just a recipe for enabling abuses under in the sort of cloud of murkiness. The real problem is that the US government is just making a series of category mistakes. They're calling things war that are not war. And that's been the view of many in the human rights community. To some extent, it's also been the view of many in the European legal community, is just to say, the US may say it's in a global armed conflict with Al-Qaeda and associated forces. It's just not. You know, that's just a mistake, a legal error. I think that's too easy, though. You know, I think it's too simplistic a way to dismiss it. That you can't shove war back into the old box. The bigger challenge for us, which we'll be talking about more in the course of the week, is going to be how do we, if war is out of its old box, if the old rituals and the old institutions, the old norms and rules don't work anymore to do what they want them to, what we want them to do, which at its most fundamental, we want them to try to prevent the unconstrained exercise of power. If they're not doing what we want them to do, we're going to have to come up with some new norms and new institutions and not just try to sort of say, oh, just get back in that box.
Okay, two comments, questions. Sorry. The first one is related to the relationship between law and the development of technologies. Now, you have everywhere where new technologies arise, you see the law is lagging behind.
Yeah.
And it's understandable why this is happening. Now, with regard to the technologies that are being used in war, we speak about dual use. We see that there is a very intimate relationship. You cannot so easily separate the technologies, mm-hmm. biotechnology, be it now big data, surveillance, etc. The use cannot be predicted. So how do you, as a lawyer, see the interconnection between the technologies that you have now speaking about, which is to use them for specific purposes, with the other uses of technology?
Yeah.
So that's my first question. My second question, I am kind of puzzled by what I sense to be a paradox in what you are saying about putting war into the box with regard to the role of the state.
Mm-hmm.
In many ways, we are having the feeling, you know, the role of the state is being diminished. Markets are taking over. We have globalization. The nation state is no longer what it used to be. We have discussions about sovereignty, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, you seem to be saying the state in its old power, glory, whatever, you know, was very much tied to the ability and the power to define what is war.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if this is going to be eroded, I think, again, taking a larger picture, I would say we have to see it also in the context of the changing role of the state.
Mm, yeah, so let me try to take those in reverse order. Yes, you're absolutely right. It is a paradox. States are their power is eroding in all sorts of ways as they non-state actors give states more competition, whether they're terrorist groups or multinational corporations. But at the same time, when it comes to international law, states remain not the only game in town, but the central game in town. That we don't have a mechanism yet for systematically engaging any kind of non-state actor in the creation of international law. That we're seeing all sorts of interesting experiments with things like voluntary codes of conduct for corporations, and there are all sorts of ways in which NGOs are actively engaged in treaty-making processes on the outside, but they still have to work through states because that's the system that we created, right? That's all there is in terms of international lawmaking, that ultimately you have to work through states or it's not international law. It might be something else, might be norms, you know, might be codes of conduct that are widely followed, but if you want to make law, you need states to do it. And I will talk more in the next lectures about the ways in which some of the changes in the nature of warfare are also putting more and more pressure on concepts of sovereignty, which is not entirely a bad thing, but I think that the challenge is we don't have anything to replace it with, right? We get rid of that, we don't have any alternative. So no, you're absolutely right that you know, Charles Tilly's famous comment of war makes the state and the state makes war, that the state makes war not just in the sense that it wages war, it also makes war in that it is states that create the category that the law calls war. States make, when the United States says cyber attacks can constitute acts of war, it is making war. It is remaking the box called war. Redefining what goes in that box, and that although there are more and more competitors to the state, we don't yet have any other actors that we don't have any other mechanisms through which other actors can say, well, wait a second, maybe we need something a little bit different, or that's not what I think. I have a few ideas about what can be done, but not a whole lot. And I was actually, we were speaking earlier on some side conversations. I think this is going to be a generational challenge. I mean, this is not going to be something that is resolved with a new Geneva Convention conference in a couple of years. This is going to be a generational challenge on the level of the creation of the UN Charter system, which worked pretty well for several decades, although that's not very long in the grand scheme of things. But you're right. It is a paradox, and none of us really have the slightest idea what to do about it, I think. Your other question. You noted that law always lags technological developments, and that's true. You know, law is always playing catch up with the facts on the ground. And to some extent, yes, this is just another example of law playing catch up. But I think the problem goes deeper than that here for two reasons. I'm trying to think if these are really the same reason or not. But one being that if anything goes to the heart of what we mean when we talk about the rule of law, it's that fundamental. It's policing violence, and as I said, I mean, this is why every society wants to say, we know what war is. It's this and it's not that. We know what a warrior is. It's this and it's not that. And try to come up with rules and rituals that keep that line sharp. And different societies have drawn that line in very different places, but they've all wanted to have a line. And I think that part of the reason I see this as different from, say, the problem, you know, whatever problem inevitably comes up when you say, oh, look, intellectual property, well, how do we fit a computer program into that paradigm? Gee, we never thought of that. Or, you know, that it matters. Part of the answer, I think, first is just that it matters here more and differently, that it matters when we're talking about something else, because nothing goes to the heart of the human experiment in restraining raw power than this. And the other reason, and I'm not sure this is a totally distinct reason or a sort of subsidiary of that, is that I actually think that lawyers, and I say this as a law professor who helps create new baby lawyers, you know, that the lawyers are an enormous part of the problem, certainly in the United States, on this, because the legal parsing of what is permissible and what is not permissible. I think in the United States, the debate about state power and accountability has been driven almost entirely by lawyers. And the debate has not been a debate fundamentally about what kind of state do we want to be? What kind of world do we want to create? It's been a debate about, is this legal? And whenever you ask, is this legal, you go find a lawyer to tell you the answer. And whenever you ask a lawyer, is this legal, when it's the President of the United States asking a lawyer if this is legal, the answer is probably going to be, well, Mr. President, yeah, I guess that could be, you want to do it, I guess it could be legal, or Ms. President, perhaps, in the future. The lawyers think very differently about things, and the question being answered, and European lawyers are just as bad and sometimes worse. They're even more formalist than American lawyers. You know, you get an answer that is about what is a plausible interpretation of a text, not an answer about, does this make any sense? Does this help us achieve our strategic or policy goals? Does this turn us into the kind of actors we want to be? Totally different discussion. So here I think more dangerously than in any other area that I can think of, that problem of the law and reality being out of sync has consequences that are quite grave.
Actually, there was a definition I was waiting for, is the civil war. It's very strange you don't speak about civil war, because all your demonstrations about the fact that historically there was a difference between war and peace inside, mm-hmm. but what's happening when there is a civil war? It's exactly the moment where this definition doesn't work. And I'm saying that because if there is a structural change, it's not the drones. It's that most of the conflicts are civil wars. So I'm a little bit skeptical about the idea that what has changed is globalization and drones and cyber attacks. I don't think it's what you mm-hmm. see on the ground. What you see on the ground is, first, massively the violence is coming from the state against its own population, almost every year, everywhere. And second, that even when the US is using drones, it's with an agreement with the local government 90% of the time. You were speaking about Pakistan, Afghanistan, Yemen, and so on, when there was a government. It's an agreement with the local government. So I wonder if your perspective is not too American and too legalistic, you know, considering that actually, sorry about that, I'm French, so it's kind of normal thing. But you see my mm-hmm. point. It's the concrete wars are not about that, you know?
I don't agree, obviously, but I think number one, I think there is a reasonably clear legal definition of a civil war, and there are reasonably clear legal rules governing civil wars. I actually think civil wars are the easy case. But number two, I don't think that, I'm not sure it's accurate to say that the U.S. has the consent of the governments. In Pakistan, for instance, the locus of authority is itself debated. So you have, and this is a whole different subject in and of itself, right? But you have a situation in which the executive branch has at times acknowledged consent, at times denied consent, at times said that it is never given consent. You have the judiciary saying that it was not empowered to give consent. You have the parliament saying it doesn't consent. So it's more complicated. But to me, the more important thing than the sort of factual question of can Pakistan at moment X or Y be said to legally have given its consent to the U.S. use of force within its borders? Can Yemen at moment X or Y be said to have done so? Can Somalia, and still another case, be said to have done so? The more problematic claim coming from the United States, and this is something I'll talk about more in coming lectures, is that the U.S. is making a legal claim that actually goes a great deal further than state consent. The legal claim that is being made by the United States in this context, as ironically in the context of humanitarian interventions, is a claim that says that when a state is unwilling or unable to take action to address, in this case, a terrorist threat within its borders, that the U.S. reserves for itself the right to make a unilateral decision that the state is unwilling or unable to take appropriate action and use force itself. In other words, to get around the consent problem in a way that is, incidentally, is entirely circular, right? Because unilaterally, if the standard is the U.S. gets to use force inside a sovereign state when that state is unwilling or unable to take what the U.S. views as appropriate action, well, okay, so then either the state consents or the state takes appropriate action or the state doesn't consent but the U.S. says they haven't taken appropriate action. So there's actually no situation in which, under that legal theory, the U.S. is using force unlawfully inside that state on that theory. And that legal claim, the claim that one state, and it doesn't, you know, could be any state, right, the claim that one state can use force inside the borders of another when it alone has reached a decision that another state is potentially going to export a threat is really destabilizing, obviously, to the whole post-World War II collective security arrangement. It's not, it's a whole other subject, it's very much parallel to, and I think fed into by the movement behind the responsibility to protect and the logic behind humanitarian intervention, which is structurally parallel, saying if a state is unwilling or unable to protect its population, that another state may use force within its borders. So for me, I am quite troubled by the implications of that type of claim for international stability, and I think we are indeed already seeing Vladimir Putin has been quite open about the ways in which he regards the U.S. Theories about sovereignty as having paved the way for some of his own recent actions, for instance. So in some ways, I'm worried much more about that than about whether, in fact, a particular state has or hasn't consented.
Yes, as a hopefully well-educated man, I start with a compliment. I liked your talk very much. It was interesting, and I liked especially the examples from history, from Papua New Guinea.
Whenever anyone says I'm starting with a compliment, I get nervous.
But now there comes a slightly critical remark. I think that your metaphor of the boxes is misleading. You said there is a box for the war, and there's a box for not war, and then we have divided the world very neatly in two, yes, parts. A nice, lawyers like that, of course, to have clear definitions, and they need them. But if the real problem is the blurring of borderlines, as you said, between war and not war, then the whole legal system breaks down. If you don't know, is it really a war, then it's of no use to have a well-developed law, legal regime for war.
Yeah.
And so my question, very simple and easy to answer, what do we in this problem? What do we in if this is a problem of the blurring of the borderlines? I'm also have a legal background, and I would like to have
public
a clear
difference. He wants to know how do we start this?
Yes.
That's party. Lecture three. But no, that statement of the problem is exactly, to me, sounds exactly right as a statement of the problem, which is that it does us no good whatsoever to have a highly elaborated set of rules concerning the conduct of armed conflict if we can't figure out what an armed conflict is anymore, because we don't know when that set of rules applies and when a totally different set of rules apply. It does us no good whatsoever to have clear international legal rules on, jus ad bellum rules on when force can be initiated inside another sovereign country if we don't know what force is anymore, and we don't know what sovereignty means anymore. So increasingly, it does seem to me that we're reaching a moment where we have a highly elaborated legal framework, but consensus has broken down on two things, and they're related, but they're slightly different. Consensus has broken down both on when we apply which body of rules, so that's that threshold problem, what's a war, what's not a war, what's force, what's an armed attack, and what's not, cyber, that's a stretch, right? But also on, even if we can all agree that there's what a war is, and let's say, and I use this example not because it's the only one, because it's probably the most familiar ones, is the context of US conflict with Al-Qaeda and its associated forces and so on and so forth. Even let's say we all agree, oh, it's a war. Even if we agree on that, we don't have any mechanism for figuring out what counts as hostilities in the context of this armed conflict, what counts as participation in hostilities, who counts as a civilian, who counts as a combatant. That so even if we have that threshold agreement, we also don't even know how to apply some of the rules within that legal framework either. And I think that is not just a problem, but increasingly is going to be a crisis. And I have no idea how to say, no, I'm kidding.
I come from Ukraine, and I also run two programs here at the Institute on Ukraine and on Russia. And what you told us this evening, I find very enlightening also in terms of this conflict. So in Russia, you can even go to prison if you make public some information on the Russia's military involvement in Ukraine. But also in Ukraine, we have been living with this kind of confusion already almost for 2 years. Mm-hmm. Are we in war? Or is it, officially it's called the anti-terrorist operation in Ukraine? And it has, of course, legal implications for people fighting on the front. Are they like fighting in the war, or is it something different? Mm-hmm. It has implications for war prisoners kept in these territories or in Russia. It has implications for war veterans, mm-hmm. For civilians affected, and so on. So my question would be, I assume that there are some hidden, implicit, very high political, moral, legal costs for a government to accept that we are at war. Mm-hmm. So what are these costs?
Yeah,
why?
You know, one of the things that's quite interesting is that traditionally, historically, states have been quite reluctant to label external meddling or internal conflicts as such. They've been reluctant to apply the war label. So the British government, for instance, was very reluctant to say that what was going on with the IRA was an armed conflict, because of precisely of the fear that would, among other things, dignify and legitimize the other side. As you know, the British wanted to be able to say the IRA are just criminals. They're not warriors. They're not an army. They're not in a conflict. You know, they're just thugs. They're just criminals, and I think we see that to some extent still going on. You know, that you say something is an armed conflict, and unless you're the George W. Bush administration in the first years after 9/11, that triggers a set of obligations as well as rights. You know, it triggers an obligation. For instance, you may be able to detain people for the duration of the conflict, but you have to let the international community, the Red Cross, in, and you don't get to treat them in various bad ways that you might otherwise want to treat them, and so forth. So there are a variety of incentives that states have at times to insist that what they're doing is not an armed conflict, not least of which is that if you're engaged in an armed conflict or you're using military force inside a foreign country, you do run into sovereignty issues. Thus, Putin also has a strong incentive to preserve, I wouldn't call it plausible deniability, it's more like implausible deniability, but at least sort of legal deniability. You say, Russia is certainly not using, I don't know who those guys are, right? They're just a bunch of, they might be Russians, they might be fighting, but they're not Russian soldiers, they're, you know. So there are certainly times when states exploit the other side of this to say it's not an armed conflict at all. Just as, you know, I mean, in some ways I was in some ways surprised, in some ways not, after 9/11 when the US was so quick to say, aha, we're in a war with Al-Qaeda, which in many ways fulfilled the fear other governments at other times have had, that that ends up legitimizing the enemy in a way that, that hurts you in the long run. So I think you're absolutely right that which direction a government goes will depend on a lot of different factors in terms of where it perceives itself as having the advantage and having greater flexibility. But okay, and I don't know if that really, if, I don't know if that fully addresses your question, but actually the one other thing I'll say about Vladimir Putin is when the United States recognized Kosovo's independence a few years back, after making all sorts of promises that it would never do that, that it would respect Serbian territorial integrity and so forth, when the U.S. and the European Union, most EU states and so forth, recognized Kosovar independence very promptly, Putin was apoplectic, and he said, and I, this is almost a direct quote, he said essentially, you states, you European states and the United States who are so quick to recognize Kosovar independence, you do not see it, but you are overturning 150 years of settled international rules about sovereignty, and this is a two-ended stick, and the other end of the stick will come back and hit you in the face. And I'm sure that as Putin contemplated doing whatever it is he did in the Ukraine, he thought to himself, it's the other end of the stick. See how you like it. So I mean, this goes back to the my answer to the question about civil wars and, you know, my concern and consent. You know, in some ways, and hopefully we'll tease this out in the next couple of conversations, but in some ways my concern is not just what has happened already, but the types of precedents and how they're likely to unfold in the coming years.
My question is concerning the role of, which we're going to address tomorrow, but I'm not going to be here tomorrow, so I'm going to ask it today, the role of technology in warfare. And you said that technology has influenced war and warfare a lot, and I'm asking myself, and now you, if it's also can be seen turned around, that war constructs technology. I mean, it's clear that war always fosters research in special research in special technologies, but is it also more of a social construction? For example, that the fear that was in the U.S. that was present after 9/11 has constructed a need for the research of drones, or, for example, also that the contemporary refugee crisis may creates a social need for border control technologies, for example, unmanned aerial vehicles to in order to guard the borders, the sea borders, or the South China conflict in this regard also.
No, I think you're absolutely right. It very much goes both ways. The technologies enable types of war making that might have been too costly or too difficult to engage in earlier, and the proliferation of new types of warfare drive the development of technologies that further fuel that, and I think that we humanity historically have not been particularly adept at finding ways to direct technological development in ways that will support more peaceful resolutions of conflict. It tends, unfortunately, to be the other way around, and I'm fairly cynical about the limited degree to which we have developed international treaties, for instance, prohibiting the use of certain types of weapons, since primarily they tend to prohibit types of weapons that have already become largely irrelevant to the needs of the states that enter into those treaties. So no, I absolutely, we see this very clearly in the United States right now, and this is absolutely is U.S. centric because that's where most of my expertise is. But certainly the old military industrial complex has become a sort of military security technological complex, and the research into new surveillance technologies, research into new weapons technologies, then does become sort of self-fulfilling because you've got it, you might as well use it, and efforts. I'll talk a little bit on, I guess, tomorrow about the development of autonomous weapons, for instance, and I think those are all genies that once they're out of the box, they're going to get used.
Thank you so much for this talk, which delineates but also try to disentangle the moral, political, the legal, but also the technological issues which transformations of warfare have involved. I really look forward to a conversation tomorrow with you on pursuing some of these topics further. Thank you very much for being with us. I'm sorry I couldn't take all the questions which were here today. Please be with us tomorrow so we can continue this conversation. Wednesday, you have the evening off. And then please be back on Thursday when we will have the last and final lecture of the series, followed then by a wine and cheese reception. Thank you very much. Thank you, Rosa.